Hi, I'm Brian Brackens with the Air Force Lifecycle Management Center's Public Affairs Office. In this leadership blog, we're speaking with Lieutenant Colonel Todd Myers. He is the material leader for ABMS.
We're doing a lot with the program on the sort of back-end infrastructure, but it's all geared towards getting to a state where we can push our mission applications out to where those decision makers, the air battle managers, et cetera, perform their mission. And then they have the data, the situational awareness, and the tools to be able to make better decisions along much faster timelines to meet the demands of the pacing threat.
Colonel, thanks so much for joining us. I'm really looking forward to talking with you. I think what you do is very interesting, and it's certainly a very, very important topic for the Air Force and the way we fight going forward in the future. So I appreciate you being here.
Yeah, absolutely. Happy to be here and eager to dig into the questions.
Awesome. So first, if you don't mind, if you just introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about what you do in your current job.
Yeah, sure. So I'm Lieutenant Colonel Todd Myers. I'm currently the materiel leader for the Advanced Battle Management System portfolio, which is really a division within the Department of the Air Force's Program Executive Office for Command, Control, Communications, and Battle Management. So I'm responsible for cost, schedule, and performance for 7 or 8 programs. And we're really just driving investments across digital infrastructure, software and apps, and aerial networking activities, working in tight partnership with a variety of stakeholders on the operational and acquisition side, and especially working closely with the Advanced Battle Management System cross-functional team at Headquarters Air Force, and then the PEO's architecture and systems engineering team. So I know we'll dig into a lot of that as we go through here, but a lot of stakeholders and a lot of programs all geared towards Advanced Battle Management System.
Okay. So what exactly is the Advanced Battle Management System?
Yeah, so I think anytime we talk about this topic, starting with the definitions is really critical. The Advanced Battle Management System has evolved quite a bit in the last 4 years. Including a variety of different sort of models for how the program was being pursued. Originally, if you go, 3 or 4 years back, Advanced Battle Management System was really multiple things. It was a set of operational concepts. It was an Air Force level initiative that was trying to drive integration across the acquisition community. And then at the end of the day, it was also a specific program element that had dollars that were going towards specific programs. So as you can imagine, that created a lot of confusion across the Air Force, the fact that it was kind of three things at the same time. And so the PEO being established under General Cropsey, the coining of the term DAF Battle Network, and really a stricter definition of what ABMS is, has been really critical. So at the end of the day, ABMS is a program element, and it is a portfolio of programs. So it is not a monolithic system. It is not a monolithic program. It's a set of investments that are being driven under that ABMS program element that we'll talk about the programs that are involved, but it's a set of activities. And so that's something that's always key, is to kind of start with how do we truly define what ABMS is?
Yeah, I agree, because I've heard several different definitions of it, and I think your description of it is perfect. So you mentioned 8 programs or activities that you're responsible for. Can you mention or go ahead and talk about a few of them?
Yeah, of course. So the way we talk about the portfolio is primarily as 4 thrust areas, and those thrust areas are driving investments across both the architecture and systems engineering work that DAF PEO C3BM is doing that defines what the DAF Battle Network is. And then additionally, there are specific acquisition strategies and programs that are defined under digital infrastructure, software and apps, and aerial networking. So I think one of our most high profile programs is cloud-based C2. Cloud-based command and control is really a tactical command and control software effort that's delivering software and infrastructure to our Air Force's air defense sectors. And then we also have additional programs under digital infrastructure that are developing secure compute and store processing nodes and network capabilities as well. So that's a few of them. We're developing a number of different products all geared towards trying to deliver secure processing, connectivity, data management, and application capabilities to where our decision makers and command and control operators actually live and work.
Okay, so this all sounds very complex. Why is it necessary?
Yeah, great question. So I think one of the really key things that's happened over the course of how ABMS has evolved within the Air Force is, you know, as the Air Force went away from JSTARS recap, you know, back 2018, 2019 timeframe, and established a different approach to how we were going to develop battle management capabilities going forward, the program really kind of set off on a very technology-centric set of activities. And they were working under the chief architect's office to say, hey, there's all this commercial technology that's out there in the world that the military is no longer driving the weight of investment on. So let's go out and get our hands on some of that commercial technology, and let's integrate it into these large force exercises that we're going to do with combatant commands. So it was really a compelling way to show what the art of the possible was for ABMS, but it wasn't delivering sustainable capabilities that we were going to manage over a life cycle and kind of had all the documentation and infrastructure that we associate with Air Force programs. So the Air Force leadership decided to take it and move it under the Rapid Capabilities Office. And they said, hey, we want you to put together the acquisition strategies, the requirements, the cost estimates, the lifecycle management plans, et cetera, that are needed to actually deliver sustainable capabilities. So the RCO spent a couple of years doing that.
Okay.
And during that time, the Secretary of the Air Force came along and he said, hey, the most important thing about this is making sure that it is delivering operational benefits, right? Which seems intuitive, but for a program that was very sort of technology centric, you know, it was a very poignant time for the program. The program was established under operational imperative number 2 at that point, and really started delivering the higher level architectures and the set of programs that that the RCO had been defining. And part and parcel of that was really the operational analysis that said, here's exactly the capabilities that we're delivering, the operational outcomes that they're going to create, and how they're actually going to help our warfighters in delivering that decision advantage that we often talk about. So in PEOC-3BM, we are always kind of focused on what is the operational outcome that our programs and architectures are trying to create. And so it depends on the program that you're actually talking about. It turns out that the DAF battle network and command and control in general are very wide ranging, right? And so kind of delving into the specifics on what is this capability actually going to deliver in terms of an advantage for our warfighters is very important. But it also depends on the particular activity, the particular kill chain, the particular analysis that you're doing. So I think that's a long answer to your question, but really at the end of the day, it depends on the capability we're developing, but we're always after creating that decision advantage by equipping our C2 operators and decision makers.
Okay. So I'm trying to break this down as simply as I can. So essentially, is this all about collecting information and then making decisions about whatever that information about the battlefield is?
Yeah, so I think one of the very useful constructs for us on the program side is something Secretary Kendall challenged us with early on. And he said, so in his mind, we were looking to take data, tactically relevant data from a variety of different sensor sources, deliver it to a location where a decision maker actually, you know, performs their C2 function in order to help them create a better decision along a faster timeline so they could meet the demands of the highly contested environment. So we're doing a lot with the program on the sort of back-end infrastructure, secure compute and store, connectivity, radios, that sort of thing. But it's all geared towards getting to a state where we can push our mission applications out to where those decision makers, the air battle managers, et cetera, you know, perform their mission, and then they have the data, the situational awareness, and the tools to be able to make, again, you know, better decisions along much faster timelines to meet the demands of the pacing threat.
And you briefly talked about this already, but just from a warfighter's perspective, can you talk just a little bit more about how what you're doing is going to help speed up the kill chain?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think, you know, if you go out to some of the places where our operation centers, our air defense sectors, the different nodes in our network where our C2 operators, you know, perform their mission on a daily basis, they need capabilities that ABMS is developing to improve their ability to quickly bring in data and then have the tools at their disposal that allow them to quickly identify if there's an anomalous track or a threat or something they need to be aware of on the Blue Force disposition side, and have those tools at their fingertips. Often today, right, they're looking at multiple screens, multiple different systems, and doing a lot of manual correlation and a lot of extremely manual tasks that we are trying to bring automated workflows to, and different software applications that just put better tools at their fingertips to be able to manipulate data. I think the kind of familiar banner for some of these things was Sense, Make Sense, and Act, right? So that was kind of a way that Air Force leadership was trying to conceptualize, hey, we need to bring sense to data and be able to make a decision and move out quickly.
Okay. So are you working with other services? And if so, like, can you talk a bit about that work and, you know, how if the Air Force is different?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think under the combined joint all domain command and control umbrella, that's really a joint warfighting concept that the joint staff owns and drives activities under. Each of the services has an effort that contributes to that CJADC2 is the acronym, that CJADC2 overall joint warfighting concept. So the Air Force's is the Advanced Battle Management System and ultimately the DAF Battle Network. The Navy's is Project Overmatch. The Army has an activity called Project Convergence. And so we have, you know, for the last few years been working very closely with the Navy and Army to bring to bear what we are doing on the BMC2 Battle Management Command and Control capability development side for the Air Force into a joint integrated set of capabilities with those other services. So within PEO C3BM, the architecture team works very closely with the other services to make sure that the DAF battle network, the operational analysis, and the architecture recommendations that come out of that team are informed by what's going on in the larger joint community. And then in the ABMS program office, we have engineers working tightly with other service representatives on things like application development and infrastructure capabilities that we intend to deploy in the coming years.
Is your team like working on getting all of our platforms to be able to talk to each other? Is that a part of your portfolio?
Yeah, so I think there are very sweeping terms applied to ABMS a lot of times, like, are we making all the platforms talk to each other? Especially as a program manager on my side, I think it's very important to be clear about what are the integrations we're driving in alignment with that DAF battle network architecture. So there are a variety of activities going on across the Air Force. I think I mentioned the DAF Battle Network consists of at least 50 programs. And it's really the confluence and integration of all of those programs that are delivering an integrated enterprise. So fundamentally, ABMS wants to drive integration with those weapon system platforms. And that is very tightly integrated into a lot of our programs that are going on, but we do it very much in partnership with a variety of other program offices that either own the weapon system development or will be responsible for scaling capabilities further in those types of activities. So I think it's important there to just be specific about integrations that we're trying to deliver and be disciplined as a program on when and how we're developing those activities.
Let's talk a bit about just the use of AI and machine learning, and, you know, what is your team involved in AI or using AI and machine learning within the program?
Yeah, so I think a very popular question these days, right, for good reason. Super compelling technology being developed on the commercial side, and then a lot of very interesting programs on the defense industry side as well, that we are working to wrap our hands around and understand how those capabilities should be folded into a C2 enterprise context. So, you know, as you can imagine, leadership is very keyed in on how are we going to prepare ourselves to integrate more advanced AI and ML capabilities. We're involved with some of those activities now, specifically around things like course of action generation. How do I bring in a large amount of data, organize it in a way that our operators are able to quickly manipulate it, have different levels of modeling and detection applied to that data so that they can be equipped with suggested courses of action rather than doing all the manual correlation that I was referencing earlier. I think the thing we try to really focus in on ABMS right now is all of the underlying enabling capabilities that are required to actually bring in that AI ML tooling layer. So things like the data architecture, the secure compute and store infrastructure that's needed to power those capabilities, that's kind of our near-term focus. While we do some application development that could be characterized as AI ML capabilities as well. So we're really focused on getting kind of the blocking and tackling right on the infrastructure and data architecture side, which really will facilitate that follow-on AI ML capability development.
Okay. So is what you do, is it being driven by requirements from the warfighter or things that they're telling you that they need, or are you just looking at the big picture to say this is what the Air Force needs, this is how we're going to fight in the future?
Yeah, great question. Always an interesting question to program manager on what the requirements development side of the house is doing. ABMS has been somewhat unique in its approach to that. We have, like I mentioned earlier, an ABMS cross-functional team at the headquarters Air Force level. They are really the requirements owning organization that's driving a coherent requirements development landscape for ABMS. Okay. With an enterprise as varied and large as the command and control enterprise, that CFT function is really critical. There are also really important requirements owners like Air Combat Command. We do a lot of work with unit level folks to make sure that there's tight operator feedback into our delivered capabilities, so we can be factoring in, you know, what are the folks who are really, you know, at an air defense sector, for example, saying about what we need to develop, how are things working, what do we need to drive in terms of new feature development. So I'd say it's sort of a multi-tiered approach there, where we have the headquarters Air Force level cross-functional team. We've got a strong MAGCOM voice from folks like Air Combat Command and Pacific Air Forces and U.S. Air Forces in Europe. We have direct unit level interaction that's helping us really stay tight with those operators at the ground level. And then very importantly for us, PEOC-3BM has an architecture team that's led by a guy named Dr. Tipton. And they're developing architecture requirements that are critical to us to make sure that we're delivering as part of a cohesive enterprise with the remainder of those DAF battle network programs. So there's a lot of different sort of avenues for requirements development that are applicable to ABMS. And that's kind of a landscape of who that consists of right now.
How do organizations like the Air Force Lifecycle Management Center fit into all of this? You know, is the center writing the code? You know, are the PEOs and directors, are they acquiring the hardware for all of this? If you don't mind just touching a little bit on that.
Yeah, of course. So very importantly, PEOC-3BM is comprised of Air Force Lifecycle Management Center personnel. It's comprised of Rapid Capabilities Office personnel, comprised of Air Force Research Lab personnel as well. So the PEO draws on expertise from a number of different sources within the Department of the Air Force's acquisition enterprise. There are Space Force personnel involved as well from places like the Space Systems Center. There is a great representative set of folks on the team that are helping to define the DAF battle network and then deliver capabilities within the ABMS portfolio. So to answer your question, LCMC is directly folded into my program office. That's where most of our personnel come from. And then just to go another kind of lens on it, we're For all of our programs under the ABMS portfolio, we're partnering directly with other program offices. So whether they're program offices at Hanscom, Wright-Patt, Space Systems Center, like I mentioned earlier, obviously our Test Enterprise folks down at Eglin, we're partnering directly with those programs to make sure that ABMS is delivering capabilities that lean on some of those enterprise solutions that have been developed by all our great program office partners. So there's multiple ways AFL-CMC is contributing to ABMS, both in terms of my team specifically, and then also in these deep program partnerships that we've developed with folks like Kessel Run and Mesh1T and many others.
Current conflicts around the world, are those in any way influencing the development of your program in any way?
Yeah, absolutely. So I mentioned the cross-functional team. I mentioned the PEO's architecture team. Those are the folks that are really driving the operational analysis that goes into defining the requirements and the technical architecture that plays a heavy role in defining what ABMS will actually deliver. So I would say, you know, drawing on the lessons that are being learned in current conflicts is a critical piece of that. I would also say that capabilities that we're developing, General Cropsey has a philosophy where we want to be kicking capability out the door from ABMS on a quarterly basis. So that's obviously a pretty significant departure compared to some of our more traditional programs in the past. But part of that is we're trying to continuously deliver capabilities and then bring that feedback in from the unit level folks that I mentioned earlier. And, you know, those unit level personnel are really the ones who are seeing what's going on, you know, in theater and then factoring that into the feedback they're giving us that we then use to do further feature development and deliver future capabilities. So absolutely, I think that's a key part of kind of the vector we're on as a program office and making sure we're staying current on, you know, what we're seeing in the conflicts out there.
It sounds like there's a big logistics piece in this as well. Just listening to you talk.
Yeah, absolutely. So I think, you know, one of the things we're trying to wrap our arms around as a program that's doing a variety of different prototyping activities with, you know, a wide swath of commercial technologies is how do we need to structure our sustainment plans and our lifecycle management plans to be able to ensure the technology in the field stays current. And so we're able to update and continually modernize that capability, but also make sure that, you know, the operators in the field are very familiar and trained up on what that technology entails, how they maintain it, how we support it from a program office standpoint, a logistics standpoint. So absolutely, I think that's a key part of what we are developing a variety of programs for right now is to inform that approach to how we are going to sustain and support the logistics tails that come with the capabilities that we're developing.
Cool. It sounds like you have a very, very tough job. Just thinking about all that you have to do, all the pieces like in the data that you're, you know, that you're responsible for supporting. It sounds challenging.
It's definitely a challenge. It's a very dynamic program. We are extremely fortunate to have a very talented team and really a multidisciplinary team. We have embedded air battle managers in the program office. We have extremely capable engineers and program managers. We have the support of the ABMS cross-functional team at the headquarters level, great support from the MAGCOMs, great support from unit level folks. So it's definitely a challenging program. It's a high visibility program. And with that comes a lot of support from leadership and you know, it's really the talent of the team that's allowing us to manage that complexity and continue to deliver.
Sir, that's all the questions that I have so far. Is there anything that you would like to add?
No, I think that was a pretty good rundown on the landscape of the program. I would just say, you know, we're keenly focused on making sure that we're very responsive to operator needs across, you know, a very far-reaching command and control enterprise. So we're working closely with our architecture team, working closely with warfighters, and trying to keep up the momentum we've built over the last couple of years and ensure that operators are starting to get that capability in their hands. And we're developing the robust programs that can keep supporting them for years to come.
Awesome. Well, thanks so much again for stopping by to talk. I think the work that you're doing is super important to the Air Force, and especially the Air Force's success going forward. And I look forward to talking with you again about new updates and the next steps with your organization.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks for having me, and appreciate all the questions and curiosity about ABMS.